I talked about funding in large programs, and some funding for large programs is also provided by non-governmental organizations or governments. Recently, on promoting sexual and reproductive rights in developing countries, and on the one hand, these efforts are very laudable because they aim to increase knowledge among youngsters about sexuality and about a good, healthy sexual experience and healthy sexual relations. But on the other hand, they carry the danger in them that we take a far too Western perspective on things, and that we impose our ideas about how a good sexual life or a marital life should look like. And but at the same time, we thought, well, it will provide a great opportunity to hire non-Western scholars in order to do the research, in order to find out really what people in the field or the women who are the subject of, or the object of these programs really think about it themselves. And if you're in gender studies, of course, you have a lot of people who are interested in anything gender, but also in topics that other supervisors are not eager to supervise. And sometimes anthropologists would say, oh, I don't know anything about the topic, if they wanted to know about homosexual subgroups in Cairo or or Brazil. And usually these students would come to me because I thought most topics are very interesting, and you know, let them do the thing they wanted to do. But also in the times of HIV, there was a lot of interest in studies on sexuality. So we had a student doing research on the ABC of safe sex in Senegal. And then we had a young woman from Zimbabwe, Irishiri Pinda, working on how women, married women, or different groups of women, so the girls, married women, and divorced women, how they would defend themselves against HIV infections in Zimbabwe. And the idea was that a lot of these programs are very much directed at use condoms, use abstinence, be careful, but they don't take into account that women are at a reproductive age really want to have sex because they want to have children, and how do you protect yourself in such situations, and how is information transferred from one group of women to the other, and in kitchen parties, for instance, where women are informed about their sexuality and learn proper behavior or learn to protect themselves. And in a way, I thought these were interesting questions. And although I did my own major research was not about sexuality, I did write a few pieces on sexuality. For instance, comparing Islam and Christianity in their views on sexuality of women, and showing that from the Christian point of view, we sort of think we are always better than the others, while actually, as to women's rights, if you look at abortion, for instance, was accepted in Islam long before it was accepted in Christianity, or women's rights to sexual satisfaction or children was too. Sorry. And very interesting research, and I worked closely together with her because she also came out of the non-governmental organization world and had worked in that area on sex education for a long time, was done by Annie Peters on the female condom, and her thesis was aptly called Fumbling with the Female Condom, because she showed that in a situation where, like say in some countries in Africa, HIV infection is especially rampant among women. Originally it was seen as a gay disease, but increasingly women became more infected, and now in Africa below the Sahara, far more women than men are infected. So if you look at young people between age 15 and 24 years of age who are infected with HIV, it turns out that 76% are women. So it's becoming a women's disease. And in this context of a women's disease, you wonder why the female condom is not promoted as the male condom is, because everyone talks about the male condom as a protective device. And actually, the female condom is a very relatively cheap, it's effective, it protects against pregnancy, but it also protects against HIV infection. And so the sole question is, why don't we know about it? And the strange thing is, we don't know about it. For fun, I went to all kinds of drugstores in the Netherlands and asked, do you have the female condom? And they looked very surprised at me. Oftentimes, occasionally they said yes, but most of the times they said, no, we have condoms, look at the condoms. And then I saw 10 types of male condoms, but no female condoms. And that's already typical and an indication, why are there no female condoms, and especially not in the area where they very much want it. So she did all kinds of research, sort of the main explanation was women don't want it. So she looked at studies where women were actually not only asked, would you like to use the female condom, because if they'd never seen the thing, they would say no, but she asked especially in studies where the women who were giving explanations, who were giving the opportunity to use it, and who actually had used it. And if you then ask, would you like to have the female condom, they would say yes. So it was not a question that, it was too easy to say women don't want it, because most women just never heard about it, were not informed. Secondly, the thing was so expensive. It's a very low cost device and easily to spread and sell everywhere. I mean, it does not need refrigerators or all kinds of costly outfit to sell it. Male condoms are spread everywhere. Why not the female condom? Still, it turns out to be 20 times more expensive than the male condom. So it's just too expensive for a lot of women. And it's not available around the corner like the male condom is. And moreover, a lot of agencies sort of feel uncomfortable with it themselves, because they have the idea, well, women don't have control over their sexuality, so they can't freely use a female condom. But if they don't have a female condom, they just can't take control over their own sexuality. So it would be a perfect means to give them control over their own sexuality. And moreover, it's better geared to the situation in many African countries than all these other techniques that you can provide with foams and more expensive devices developed for the Western world, or developed for a situation where people have money and more interest. So it depends on the organizations who or the companies who make them. It depends on the states who fund them. It depends on Even at a certain moment, Trump or in America, all kinds of programs for the sexual education of people in developing countries and means of controlling the sexuality were blocked because the conservative Christians did not think that was a proper thing to spend your money on. And so I really like that research because I think it was very useful, and still we find sometimes it's taken up by African women who want to develop programs on spreading the female condom, but still in Europe it is as if it just doesn't exist, or it's not an issue at all. But that in times of problematic infective diseases. And later on we got an opportunity to start a program on sexual and reproductive health in Bangladesh, and I thought that would be a good opportunity to work together with Bangladeshi universities, with agencies for sex education. And actually we managed to get in two different programs, but they all had the same idea of promoting sexual and reproductive health among Bangladeshi women. And we found some Bangladeshi women who worked as anthropologists for us, and also because they were anthropologists, we thought it was very important that they design their own research again. And they had the advantage, of course, of speaking the local languages and knowing all the nuances and knowing how difficult it can be to talk about sexuality and ask people about what they do in bed. But Maritika Barua just finished her thesis, and she came out of the field of tuberculosis prevention in Bangladesh. And tuberculosis is, of course, an infectious disease like HIV, but also more like COVID. It's spread by your lungs and by contact. And you can imagine that sexual contact is problematic for married people. She only included married people, so she did research on how both women and men, how they behaved in a situation of being one of them infected with tuberculosis, and what it would mean in terms of sexual health and rights over sexuality. And it was interesting that she compared the two, because then you could see that for women it had quite different effects than it sometimes had for men. For men, it was more an issue of losing their sense of masculinity because they were not supposed to perform sexually. And for women, it was a danger for their, it could be a danger for their marital life, especially because, of course, all the families are also involved in it, and the mother-in-law may decide that she's too dangerous, or that she has to go home while she's ill and should not have a sexual relation with the son to prevent infection. So she just finished. We are still working on the article of the man, and she finished another article for the public health community, because it turned out that in the information that the public health workers on all levels give to the patients, all kinds of notions about propriety and about how do you talk about sexuality and how do you explain that you should not sleep together, you know, all these avoiding words that are being used and that are sometimes misunderstood by the patients because they're not clear and they do not really want to say what's going on and what you should do or should not do. So in a way it could be very helpful, I think, for health workers to find out what people mean if they say certain things so that they can react properly and give the proper information. Another Bangladeshi researcher, Shuborna Kamelia, is now finishing her thesis in Mritika Barwa. By the way, she defended her thesis, which was a little bit a sad affair because it was in the middle of the COVID restrictions, so she could not travel, and the committee could not gather, so everything went by Zoom. So the only two persons present was the replacing dean of the university and me as the supervisor, which was kind of sad for her because she missed the whole party and festivities afterwards. But her companion, Shuborna Kamelia, is still writing up her thesis, and she chose another input. She wanted to know what youngsters in Dhaka, the capital of Bangladesh, thought about sexuality. And she had a strange experience. She's in her 30s, I think, that when she made appointment with young people, they had all their dreams of how they would move abroad and see movies and talk about sex and do sexual things. And she was there as a married woman and not daring to ask questions. And then they said, "Ah, I thought you were going to ask us about sex. Why don't you?" But together they found out what the value of silence and non-silence was in the relation with the parents, and when the parents should be informed about the sexual activity of their children or not, and why not, and this topic. But it's kind of interesting because I kept saying to them, what we want to hear is not this jargon of women are oppressed and they can't do anything, but we want to hear what women themselves, or boys for that matter, think and what they do. So tell us what the people say and what they think, and if they think about sexuality, what terms do they use, and what are their arguments, and so let us know what the local version is of this situation, and not impose in order to avoid imposing our ideas when women or men are sexually healthy or have reproductive rights. So that's it.